So it's true that my wife and I had our first baby recently, 4 months ago. And a couple weeks after he arrived, I found myself holding this screaming child. There was poop everywhere. And I realized that the title of my next book is going to be Everything in My Last Book Was Bullshit. which brings me to one of the caveats I should issue early is that I swear a lot when I'm not on television. My parents don't like it, but they don't have the mic. So if you had told me not too long ago that I was ever going to end up as a kind of traveling evangelist for meditation, I would have coughed my beer up through my nose. This was not in the cards. But funny things happen, and for me, it all started with a panic attack on national television about 10 years ago. It happened on a little show that some of you might have heard of called Good Morning America. And because I'm a huge masochist, I actually asked our research department to find out exactly how many people were watching, and they came back with the number 5.019 million. So, no big deal. In this clip I'm about to show you, which is why I'm looking down right now, assuming I don't disappoint Pierce here, I give you a blow-by-blow of my on-air Waterloo. So here it is. Sorry, that sentence ends with national television. So I get two responses to that video. One is if anybody's ever had any dose of panic in their lives, they know exactly what they're looking at. The other is, it didn't look like much of a big deal at all. I'm actually happy that it didn't look like that big of a deal, but I can tell you internally it was the most terrifying thing that has ever happened to me. And in a weird and windy way, however, it led to something that really has improved my life, which I will talk about in a few minutes. But I want to drill down on how embarrassing that event was on many, many levels, because there is a backstory here that is even harder to tell, which is, let me just say this. I think at the root of that panic attack is something that I would imagine many people in this room share, which is a desire to be great at whatever you're doing. And for me, this was a really strong desire. I arrived at ABC News. There's the picture they took of me on my first day. I arrived at age 28. I came from a little station here in Boston called NECN, and this picture, despite my begging and pleading, is still on my security ID at ABC. And one of my friends has joked that if you take a wider shot, it may reveal me to be holding a balloon. I was terrified and working with giants in our industry, like Diane Sawyer and Peter Jennings and Barbara Walters, and I was really insecure about how green I was, and my way of compensating for being green was to throw myself into the job and become a workaholic. I had a motto that I had inherited from my dad, which he later explained, actually, it was not his own personal model. It was a motto that he imparted to me to help me feel better about being a warrior. But the motto was, the price of security is insecurity. So I come from a family where worrying is venerated, and I just took that to the hoop, proverbially, and really believed that the more worrying I did about what is my, you know, what stories do I have cooking, what's my relationship with the major anchors or the executives, how was my last story, what other correspondents are getting what, blah, blah, blah. This kind of mental churn, I believed, was responsible for any success I might have achieved and might achieve in the future. Along those lines, when 9/11 happened not long after I got to ABC News, I raised my hand and volunteered to go overseas and cover whatever happened next. This is a picture of me with some nice young men from the Taliban. This is actually just a few weeks after 9/11. I managed to get into Kandahar in southern Afghanistan while the Taliban were still in charge. And the dirty little secret about covering war is that, at least in my case, I loved it. And people don't often talk about it in this way, but I loved it because I firmly believed and continue to believe that it's extremely important work. But I also loved it because it is thrilling. As I think Winston Churchill once said, there's nothing more thrilling than the bullet that misses you. And luckily for me, they all missed. And I was hooked, really, and I spent the subsequent years in places like Afghanistan and Pakistan and Israel and the West Bank and Gaza. I made 6 trips to Iraq. And when I came home from one of those trips, I got depressed. This was in the summer of 2003. Somewhat embarrassingly, I didn't actually know I was depressed, although I was exhibiting what I now know to be some of the trademark symptoms. I was having trouble getting out of bed. I felt like I had a low-grade fever all the time. And at this point, I did a toweringly stupid thing, which was I started to self-medicate with recreational drugs, including cocaine and ecstasy. This is when the hush falls over the room. I hasten to add, it was not like that movie, The Wolf of Wall Street. I wasn't doing it every day, definitely not when I was working, definitely not when I was on the air. As I like to say, I was stupid, but not that stupid. After the panic attack, actually I had 2 panic attacks. After the second panic attack, I went to a doctor in New York City, who's an expert in panic, and he asked me a series of questions to try to get to the root of the panic. And one of the questions was, do you do drugs? And I kind of sheepishly said, yeah, I do. And he leaned back in his chair and gave me a look that communicated the following sentiment, which was, okay, asshole, mystery solved. And he explained that even though my drug use had been reasonably sporadic, it was enough, he said, to artificially raise the level of adrenaline in my brain and to prime me to have this panic attack. Or as I said, 2 panic attacks. So that was a big aha moment for me. I realized how stupid I'd been, and I made 2 big decisions. One is I quit doing drugs, which was kind of a no-brainer. And the other is that I agreed to go see this shrink once or twice a week, indefinitely. This is not, however, a neat, tidy story where I quit doing drugs, become a Buddhist, and my life is a nonstop parade of unicorns and rainbows. Something else had to happen. In this case, it was an assignment given to me by this gentleman, Peter Jennings, who was my mentor at the time. And he took me aside and said, you're going to cover faith and spirituality for ABC News. And I said, no, I don't want to do that. And I tried to explain to him that I am, as you all know, from right here in the People's Republic of Massachusetts, and my parents are secular scientists. I did, as was mentioned, have a bar mitzvah, but I did this only for the money. So I had no interest in this subject area whatsoever. Unless, I mean, they were gonna pay me $6,000, which is what I got from my bar mitzvah, which was awesome. Peter said, I hear you, but I don't care, you're gonna do it anyway. So I went off and spent many, many years in places like mega churches and mosques and Mormon temples, and it turned out to be an amazing thing for me. I made a lot of really good friends. I realized how ignorant I was on this issue, and I really saw the value of having a worldview that transcends your own narrow interests, which was very useful for me as a young man on the make. And that being said, none of what I encountered spoke to me personally. I didn't go kosher or anything like that until the year 2008. So several years after the panic attack and several years after starting to cover faith, one of my producers recommended I read a book by this guy. I don't know if people know who he is. His name is Eckhart Tolle. I hadn't heard of him, so don't worry if you haven't, but he is, my producer explained, a hugely successful self-help guru, beloved by celebrities like Oprah. Paris Hilton actually carried one of his books into jail on her DUI charge. I don't know if that's a recommendation that you want to take seriously, but anyway, a big deal. She thought maybe he'd be worth doing a story on. So I ordered one of his books, and I started to read it. And at first, it struck me as irredeemable bullshit, just like hardcore bullshit, with all this strange language about vibrational fields and pseudoscientific claims and grandiose claims about how this book was going to provoke in you, the reader, a spiritual awakening, whatever that means, and how after his own spiritual awakening, he lived for 2 years in a state of bliss on park benches in the city of London. I am not a meteorologist, but as I understand it, they have winter in London. So I was deeply unimpressed by this book. But I continue to read, I don't know why, and I'm glad I did, because as I continued to read, he started to unfurl a fascinating thesis about the human condition, something that I'd personally never heard before. Tolle's argument is that we all have a voice in our heads, by which he is not referring to schizophrenia or hearing voices. He's talking about your inner narrator, the voice that chases you out of bed in the morning and yammers at you all day long and has you constantly wanting stuff, rejecting stuff, judging people, comparing yourself to other people, judging yourself really harshly. Here's one of the hallmarks, thinking about the past or thinking about the future to the detriment of whatever's happening right now. One of my friends, Sam Harris, who's also a writer, we're not related, but we're friends. He has said that when he thinks about the voice in his head, he feels like he's been hijacked by the most boring person alive who says the same shit over and over again, most of it negative, all of it self-referential. And Tolle's argument is when you're unaware of this nonstop conversation you're having with yourself, it yanks you around. This is why you find yourself with your hand in the fridge when you're not hungry, or you're checking your email in the middle of a conversation with another human being, or you're losing your temper when it's strategically unwise. And for me, this was another huge aha moment, because I realized two things. A, this is just intuitively true. This is why heads are nodding right now, this thesis. And two, the voice in the head idea explained the most embarrassing moment of my life. This is why I went off to war zones without really thinking about the psychological consequences, came home, got depressed, was insufficiently self-aware to know it, and then blindly self-medicated, and it all blew up in my face. Suffice it to say, it was mildly embarrassing to be reading a book by this guy and thinking he gets me. But the bigger problem was, as I continued to read, I couldn't see any practical, actionable advice for dealing with the voice in the head. So I went and interviewed him, and to the delight of the producer who suggested it, I flew to Toronto and sat in some nondescript hotel room and interviewed Eckhart Tolle. And so the first question I asked him was, what do you do about the voice in the head? I'm in, what do I do? And he took a beat and said, take one conscious breath. And the voice in my head was thinking, what the fuck does that mean? And I kept pressing him about this, you know, this issue of what do you do about this problem that you have so clearly identified. And he seemed unwilling or unable to offer me anything that I could understand. And actually, things even got a little weirder when I, at one point, I asked him whether he ever gets into a bad mood. Here's what he had to say. Hopefully, the audio will be loud enough for you to hear this.
Don't you ever get annoyed, irritated, sad, anything negative?
No, I accept what is. And that's why life has become so simple.
Well, somebody cuts you off and they're getting in your car?
It's fine. It's like a sudden gust of wind. I don't personalize a gust of wind. And so it's simply what is.
And you're able to enjoy every moment, even if I start asking a ton of annoying questions.
Yes, that would be fine. So it's really...
Don't tap me.
All right, so he's a very frustrating man, as you can see. It was like, and I said this in my book, it was like he had pointed out that my hair was on fire and then steadfastly refused to give me a fire extinguisher. Now, I didn't actually know what to do next because this was all new to me. As you'll see in a moment, it is not new, but it was new to me. So I, again, not knowing what to do, I sort of threw myself into the world of self-help, which, as some of you may know, is not a pretty place. It's filled with a lot of people who will tell you that you can get whatever you want through the power of positive thinking, which ain't true. And I can get on my high horse about the venality of this particular corner of our culture in the Q&A if anybody would like, but in the interest of moving things along, I will just say that I was at wit's end. And I came home one night, and my then fiance and now baby mama Bianca said to me, "I've been hearing you talk about the voice in the head and Eckhart Tolle with varying levels of cogency, and I've got a gift for you." It reminded me, all of your talk reminded me of a book I read many years ago by this guy. And here's the book. And this guy is a doctor. Trained here at Harvard. He's a psychiatrist. His name is Dr. Mark Epstein. His dad was, in fact, one of the editors, the editor of the New England Journal of Medicine, right? Or yeah, anyway, I digress. Epstein, he's a real guy. He actually has qualifications, is my point. And he writes about the overlap between psychology and Buddhism. So I started to read his book that night, and I had another aha moment. I realized that all of the stuff that I liked most about Eckhart Tolle seemed to have been lifted largely without attribution from the Buddha. Notwithstanding the fact that I was ostensibly a religion reporter, I knew zero about Buddhism, other than the fact that when I was a 15-year-old punk kid, I actually stole a Buddha statue from a local gardening store. I put it in my bedroom because I thought it looked cool. Do you still have that? And now I might actually like it. So anyway, I didn't know anything. But it turns out that 2,500 years before Tolle started cashing his royalty checks, it was this guy, heretofore known to me only as a lawn ornament, who was talking about the voice in the head. He had a different terminology. He called it the monkey mind. According to the Buddha, we are all like furry little primates lurching through a forest of urges and impulses and desires, constantly latching onto things that will not last in a universe characterized by impermanence, and hurling ourselves from one hit of pleasant experience to the next, one meal, one vacation, one social encounter to the next, and yet never fully satisfied. Now think about it. How many great movies have you seen? How many great lattes have you sipped? How many great promotions? Whatever. And are you done? Of course not. We are insatiable. And in this way, the pursuit of happiness enshrined in our founding documents becomes the source of our unhappiness. So here we go. The thesis explicated quite clearly. And unlike Eckhart Tolle, the Buddha actually has a simple, practical piece of advice. The problem for me at this point was what he suggests I found repulsive, which was meditation. My view at the time was that meditation is only for freaks and hippies and weirdos and people who live in a yurt and are really into aromatherapy and Cat Stevens and John Tesh and wear little finger symbols and make dream catchers and put them on the wall and use the word namaste without ironing. It turns out I was not actually entirely wrong about that. I saw this clip, I'm going to use it. My view was really well summed up by Alec Baldwin's character on 30 Rock, who said the following.
Meditation is a waste of time, like learning French or kissing after sex.
I want to be clear, I don't actually believe that. It's just a funny clip. Then I did a little research. And I found out that despite its massive PR problem, there's actually been an explosion of scientific research into meditation. Now, this research is still very much in its infancy, but there have been, I think it's safe to say, many hundreds of studies done in the last decade or so, which strongly suggest a tantalizingly long list of health benefits. Those include lowering the release of stress hormones, lowering your blood pressure, boosting your immune system, mitigating depression, anxiety, ADHD, age-related cognitive decline, becoming increasingly important to me. And it seems to help with seemingly unrelated things like psoriasis and irritable bowel syndrome, which both have stress components. And things get really sci-fi when you start talking about the neuroscience. Scientists have been peering into the brains of meditators and finding out that, and I'm going to put this in a sort of pseudoscientific way, so excuse me, but they're finding out that when you meditate, you're performing, in essence, a kind of neurosurgery on yourself. And it's not just people who wear robes. I'm going to tell you very quickly about a study done here at Harvard in 2011 by a researcher named Sarah Lazar. This is a fantastic and fascinating study, which took people who had never meditated before, so I imagine like most of the people in this room, and they scanned their brains. And then over the subsequent 8 weeks, they had these people do just a little bit of meditation every day. So they didn't make them monks or anything like that. They had them live their regular lives, but they did a short daily dose of meditation. And then at the end of 8 weeks, they scanned their brains again. And what did they find? They found that the area of the brain associated with self-awareness and compassion, the gray matter, literally grew. And in the area of the brain associated with stress, the gray matter literally shrank. Very compelling stuff, especially for me as a skeptic. And then the next thing I learned was that meditation does not involve a lot of the things that I assumed it involved. For example, you don't have to sit in a funny position. This is my cat, Ruby. The woman who took this picture doesn't like when I mention that, so I won't name her, but her name rhymes with Shmianka. This cat is basking in the reflective glow of the Real Housewives of New Jersey. You don't have to sit in a funny position, you don't have to join a group, you don't have to believe in anything, you don't have to wear special outfits, you don't have to pay any fees. Meditation has been, due to the work of a man named Jon Kabat-Zinn, who was based here in Massachusetts, trained at MIT, and is now at UMass Worcester, where he runs the Center for Mindfulness, meditation has now been secularized and taught in a form known as mindfulness-based stress reduction. So it's simple, secular, and to a large extent, scientifically validated. And then the next thing I learned is that, just to amplify this point about simplicity, the three steps for mindfulness meditation are eminently doable. I'm not going to make you do it, but just so you know, I'll explain the three steps. Just as a little aside, this is so simple that I taught one of the tech reporters for the New York Times how to meditate in fewer letters than it takes to send a tweet. So the first step is to sit comfortably with your back upright. Usually people close their eyes, although you don't have to. The second is to focus your full attention on the feeling of your breath coming in and going out. Pick a spot wherever it's most prominent, your nose, your chest, your belly usually, and feel your breath coming in and feel it going out. And the third step is the biggie, because as soon as you try to do this, your mind is gonna go bonkers. You're gonna start thinking about, what am I gonna have for lunch? Do I need a haircut? Why did I say that dumb thing to my boss? Why did Dances with Wolves beat Goodfellas for Best Picture in 1991. Why do celebrities marry only other celebrities? What, it doesn't matter. Your brain's going to go nuts. Your mind is going to go nuts. And the whole game is to notice when you've become distracted and to start over and over and over and over and over. And every time you do that, it's a bicep curl for your brain, and it shows up on the brain scans. It is also a radical act because you are breaking a lifetime's habit of walking around, of sleepwalking, really, in a fog of memory and projection. Meditation, I think one of the core parts of its PR problem is that people think you have to clear the mind. Clearing the mind is possible only, I believe, if you are either A, enlightened, or B, dead. It's not possible, in other words. And so the point is not to clear the mind. The point is to focus the mind for nanoseconds at a time. Get lost and start again. Get lost and start again. This is a long way of saying, despite your doubts, you can actually do this. And despite my doubts, I started to do it. This is a picture that Shmianka took of me on vacation with some opportunistic chickens trying to bum rush me. So I started with 5 to 10 minutes a day, which is what I recommend everybody start with. And I actually think 5 to 10 minutes is enough in perpetuity. And I'll be honest with you, I didn't like it. It's hard. It's really hard. I think we've been ill-served by the traditional art around meditation, and even the modern depictions of meditation, which shows people drifting off into cosmic ooze like this. I actually think this image is particularly troubling because I don't think it sends the message that it's only for upper middle class white people, which is not true. And it's worth bearing in mind that this kind of meditation was invented by an Indian dude 2,500 years ago. So this doesn't need to be the exclusive province of yuppies. But more importantly, that kind of look has never crossed my face. And it's not going to cross yours either. This is exercise for the mind. I wanted this image to be the cover of my book because I think it's a more accurate depiction of the experience of meditation. My publisher said it looked too arty, whatever. Don't get me started on publishers. I would say within a few weeks of meditating, I developed two principal benefits. The first is focus. The daily exercise of sitting down, trying to focus on one thing, which is my breath, getting lost and starting over, and getting lost and starting over, really helped me stay on task at work. Now, I'm sure we all have stressful lives. I'm not trying to claim that my life is exceptionally stressful, but I will say that I, as part of my job, I have other people's voices piped directly into my head. And I need to get it right. I need to get the facts straight under significant amount of pressure in front of large audiences and with reasonably high stakes. And again, that exercise of that I continue to do to this day of trying to focus on one thing, getting lost, starting over, really helped me in this regard. But it's the second benefit that I think is the true game changer, and is this word, very boring sounding word, mindfulness. But don't be fooled. This is a life-changing proposition, mindfulness. It's actually an ancient word. It's got lots and lots of meanings. But I'm going to give you one simple, serviceable definition, which is it's the ability to know what's happening in your head right now without getting carried away by it. I'm going to say this again because it's pretty much the only thing I'm going to say today that's useful. The rest of it is all jokes. Mindfulness is the ability to know, the skill of knowing what's happening in your squash right now without necessarily taking the bait and acting on it. So let's use an example here. You're online at Starbucks and somebody cuts you off. Generally speaking, how does that moment go for you internally? I think for most of us, it goes like this. You have an uninvited thought, which is, I'm pissed. And then what happens? I think for most of us, we automatically, reflexively, habitually inhabit that thought. We actually become pissed. There's no buffer between the stimulus and our automatic reaction to it. With mindfulness on board, just a little bit of meditating, that moment might go slightly differently. You might notice, oh, my chest is buzzing, my ears are turning red, I'm having a starburst of self-righteous thoughts, I'm getting angry. but you don't necessarily, that self-awareness then allows you to have a moment where you say, I don't necessarily need to take the bait and act on it and scream on this at this person with my kids looking at me. Which I think versions of this experience have happened to all of us, and I would argue are the source of everything we're most embarrassed about. It's a bit, this is just a rough analogy, mindfulness in that moment is a bit like the picture-in-picture function on your TV, where you, I think they still have those on TVs, where you press picture-in-picture and all of a sudden the story that's taken up the whole frame can be seen with a little bit of perspective. Another way to think about this, is Jon Kabat-Zinn's metaphor, although it's my picture, which is why it looks like shit, I drew this. Jon Kabat-Zinn talks about the mind as being like a waterfall. The curvy lines there, that's your thinking, that's the stream of consciousness, most of which revolves around Mr. Important or Mrs. Important. And mindfulness is the space behind the waterfall. It's the ability to step out of the traffic and to view the contents of consciousness with some non-judgmental remove. Just in case you think I'm just making this shit up, we are classified as a species as Homo sapiens sapiens, the one who thinks and knows he thinks. But that second sapiens has atrophy with time because nobody bothers to point out to us that we have a bonus level in our mind that, again, allows us to step out of the traffic and to view it all with some dispassion. So let me just go back to the Starbucks example for a second. I suspect some of you might be thinking, am I not justified in getting pissed off once in a while? Absolutely. There are things that are worthy of your anger, but I would argue that it's justified fewer times than you might think. But I would also add that the proposition here is not to render you into some lifeless, non-judgmental blob who just watches life from a remove. The point here is that you should have the ability to respond wisely to the things that happen to you rather than reacting blindly. Most meditation cliches make me want to put a pencil through my eye, but this meditation cliche, which is to respond, not to react, is, I think, the heart of the matter. And is extremely valuable and extremely scalable, which is why we are now seeing meditation and mindfulness adopted in some very surprising places like Google, Twitter, Procter & Gamble, Aetna, Target, General Mills. Just a word about General Mills. These are the people who make Hamburger Helper, and they have meditation rooms in every building in their corporate campus in Minnetonka, Minnesota. Other signs that this is going mainstream. This is an article from Wired magazine in which they refer to mindfulness as Silicon Valley's quote-unquote new caffeine. I think it is richly ironic that the people who have developed the products and software that are destroying our ability to focus are now adopting this ancient practice to boost their own, but maybe a hint. That's the quarterback for the Seattle Seahawks who lost to our hometown cheaters, the Patriots. Sorry, I know it's a tough joke to make in this room. It usually goes over well on the West Coast. It's being adopted in a major way in the sports world. The Seahawks, even though they're awful, terrible people, they do have a meditation coach, and they won the Super Bowl the year before. So they're good. The New York Knicks, who suck, just started meditating. Let's see how that goes. Novak Djokovic, who won Wimbledon not too long ago, also a meditator. Lots of Olympians, also meditators. So this is taking off in this corner of the culture as well. Also worth mentioning, it's taking off in entertainment. This is the lead singer of a band named Weezer. Katy Perry is meditating. 50 Cent, the rapper. I like to point out that dude got shot 9 times. He deserves some peace of mind. But perhaps most interestingly, this is now being adopted in military circles. Both the U.S. Army and the U.S. Marines are spending tens of millions of dollars to look at whether meditation can make soldiers who are more effective and wiser, making better decisions in the field, and more resilient and less prone to the scourge of PTSD, and it truly is a scourge that we're dealing with in this country. So at this point, and I'm almost done, I'm going to make a prediction. I'm going to issue yet another caveat before I make this prediction, which is that historically speaking, my powers of prognostication are a little bit weak. In the early 2000s, I convinced my little brother to invest in the company that makes the Palm Pilot. It didn't go super well. But having said that, I believe that meditation is the next big public health revolution. I think that in the not too distant future, within our lifetimes, people are going to think about physical exercise the same way they're going to think about mental exercise the same way we now think about physical exercise. You know, in the 1940s, if you told somebody you were going running, most likely they would have said, "Who's chasing you?" What happened? The scientists, including, I believe, a lot of scientists from the Harvard Exercise Physiology Lab, swooped in and proved that exercise has lots and lots of benefits. And now it's something that we all do, and if we don't do, we feel guilty about. And that's where I think we're heading with meditation. It's just going to join the pantheon of no-brainers. Now, that being said, there's a reason why I hear blatant book plug. There's a reason why I called my book 10% Happier. It is not going to solve all of your problems. I've learned the hard way. It's not going to make you taller or regrow your hair. And in many ways, I am the same guy from that picture where I was holding a balloon at age 28. You know, I'm still arguably a workaholic. I still firmly believe that if you're going to be great at anything, a certain amount of stress and striving and plotting and planning is inherent in the endeavor. I think the difference is, for me, is that with mindfulness on board, I've learned how to draw the line between what I call constructive anguish and useless rumination. And that has made a huge difference. That being said, if my wife was here, she would give you the 90% still a moron speech. My little brother, the one with the Palm Pilot, he recommended an alternate title to the book, which is From Deeply Flawed to Merely Flawed. The bottom line is, give it a shot. It is my firm belief, I have a couple of firm beliefs about meditation, that if it can be stripped of some of the unfortunate residue of the age of Aquarius, it can be made attractive to tens of millions of skeptical people who would otherwise reject it out of hand. Because at the core is a really empowering and fascinating idea, which is that happiness, which I think most of us assume, consciously or subconsciously, is dependent on external factors like the quality of your childhood, the quality of your marriage, how things are going at work. You know, all those things are really important. But in fact, happiness is a skill that you can practice, just like you can practice building your bicep in the gym. We spend so much time, all of us, working on our bodies, our stock portfolios, our interior design, our cars, and most of us spend no time working on the one filter through which you experience everything. So if I can leave you, I'll leave you actually with my little tagline, which is, if it can work for a fidgety, skeptical newsman, it can work for you. Thank you. Appreciate it.